did you. And I love your city. Thank you so much for having me here today. I really, really appreciate it. Thank you.
So, I came out in August of 2014, and at that time, the feelings that I had were like, this was crazy, it was like liberating, it was scary for so many things, you know, because now I was having to face my truth. And the funny thing is, 2 days before, I actually came out to myself. You know, I always knew that I was attracted to men. At the time, I know what it meant. I thought it was, I'm 4 years old at the time, because I knew since I was four. So I thought it was a phase at the time. I didn't really think anything of it, whatever. Now that I'm 20 and I'm coming out, I'm like, okay, I'm starting to have, I have now have to be my real self. And that was freeing, it was scary, it was just so many things. And how I came out was, I started with my sister's friend, Camille. Shout out to Camille, love you dearly still. I came out to her, I was having a conversation with her about, you know, coming out and everything. And she encouraged me to live in my truth and, you know, be who I am. But she also encouraged me to own my, not only own my truth, but to tell my truth when I was ready. And, you know, so people heard it from me versus somebody else telling my story. And from then, you know, I started slowly but surely coming out to everybody that I knew.
I was in the arts. I was the head of my fashion class. So I was already kind of, in my own opinion, I was a little different than my counterparts. So when I graduated, I met a couple of individuals in the scene. I won't say their name, but they introduced me to like my first experience of being gay. You know, at that time I was still a very young, you know, teenager, and I didn't like transition at that point. So I was very inexperienced. I didn't have much knowledge on the scene or anything. So my first experience was fresh out of high school, Albany High. I met other individuals like myself, and they introduced me to hanging out, you know, and just kind of like involving me in like gay culture, because prior to that I never had it. Like prior to that, I hung out with girls and like my friends from like my previous friends from high school. So once my new peers introduced me to the scene, that's when I got introduced to a couple of older individuals in the gay scene, which introduced me to ballroom. Because it was kind of like a segue. It was like boom, boom, boom.
Okay, next up, that once again, I'm popular right now. It's Hazel doing Blow Gay Real Blow.
So I've actually been a part of this community here in Albany for 30 years. 30 years, yes. The way I was introduced to the community is that I actually met a friend when I was in high school here. I went to Albany High School right here in Albany. And I met a friend, and that person was already engaged with the community, had been to like the bar scene, which was the only scene that was available at the time, was really just a bar scene. There was no In Our Own Voices back then. There was a gay community center that was more geared towards white people. And the gay scene in Albany was the bar scene was more for the white people. There was a small black gay scene, but it was extremely small. Most black gays back then would venture to go to New York City to experience the nightlife and to communicate with other people that were in the community. So Albany scene was, for me, it was very small, and it was very, how can I say, it was like only at nighttime. It was like a ghost town, sort of. But it was like a small best kept secret, sort of, I would say. Which is a big difference from what it is now.
Coming out wasn't necessarily easy for everybody. There were challenges in terms of, you know, relationships with family, co-workers, friends, etc., that depending where you were made it difficult. So I think back then, those of us who were able to, it was important to do that, and understanding that not everybody was in the same place. I can remember some instances. For example, a few years prior to that, there was actually a raid on a bathhouse in Central Avenue. Excuse me. That I wasn't living down here at the time, but it was in the newspaper front page, and they also published names, as I recall, of people who were arrested, and that creates a situation where if you weren't out, all of a sudden your work colleagues might be seeing you, your name in a paper, and being involved in a bathhouse someplace, and that was kind of some of the atmosphere back then. And I heard different stories about that that incident. And I remember seeing it was in the Knickerbocker News at the time. They covered it, and then they did a feature, an issue a little bit after that about why is Albany thought to have such a large gay population, and they talked, or were larger than normal, whatever. And it talked about the whole idea that people were attracted here because state government was a safer place to work in terms of, protection or whatever than if you were someplace else. But it was sort of interesting. But if you had looked at these articles in the Nick News when that happened.
My all experience was New York City. I was so open in New York City. Around here, just people you met, no doubt.
Yeah, I think that's all we had back then were the bars and maybe the CDGLCC. But primarily, that's all you had. And thank goodness there were like 8 or 10 bars around. So you really had your options. And I didn't really hook up with a lot of people. I really didn't. I used to be able, from 1985 to 2000, I could count the number of men I had, and I could name them and still have fingers left over. So, for 15 years,
I have a little different experience. Just a little.
Now, I do want to ask, because you brought up, again, the bar scene. Yeah. So, I do know back in the day, we had a lot more gay bars than what we have now. Can you actually name them? That were here,
whatever,
sure. Where they were.
First one I ever went to was in Menands. It was called Shangri-La.
Oh, is that where that was?
It was in Menands or North, North Albany, Menands area.
My aunt used to.
And I went in there once, and it was just, I think I was probably just 18. And back then, 18 was the drinking age, so I wasn't doing anything illegal. But it was just once. And then back in the day when Waterworks first opened, I used to go there. But, when you looked like me, you didn't get a lot of attention. So, I didn't enjoy the bars because
I did.
I
just danced everywhere. Except for in the lesbian bars, that's where I really got to know people. I would talk with strangers and really get to know them. But beyond that, I was always so afraid that any guy I ever spoke to would, it would lead somewhere where I didn't want it to go.
No.
And so I never really kind of talked with men.
In the 80s, there was a lesbian bar on Central Avenue called Esther's.
Esther's on the Avenue.
And
Number eight.
A friend of mine, a lesbian, had a band there, and I used to carry up her equipment, and I would sit there, and Esther was like, "We're gonna let you be a lesbian tonight." And I was so, Esther was so, she was so sweet to me, and all the women were.
Yeah, yeah.
I was more accepted in a lesbian bar than I was.
Yeah, I was more comfortable myself.
Yeah, me too. Yeah, so women just.
But there was the Waterworks, and above that was Secrets. That was the lesbian bar.
Secrets.
And then there was Clyde's, and there was the Playhouse. There was.
What was the piano bar? Was that the Playhouse?
That was the Playhouse. Yep. There was.
So what was it?
State Street Pub.
What was it? The parking lot across the street from the Little Motors. It became.
The Eight Ball. And then it became Rage or Rave.
Rage, yeah.
Rage. Good. And that's where I met my now spouse. Yeah. I met him on the bowling league of Rage. Yeah. And
Phoenix.
The Phoenix, yeah. And Esther had a bar called the Falcon in Schenectady.
Yeah.
And there was another bar in Schenectady.
Well, so Clinton still Street. There. Clinton but Street. Really, you know, it's still open.
Yeah, it's still there.
Yeah.
State Street Pub I mentioned, and of course O Bar. But I think that was the number.
Hollywood used to be kind of like a gay bar.
Yeah, Hollywood was kind of alternative.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, were there any downtown Albany, as far as you can remember?
No, but you forgot the one in Latham, too. Upstairs, downstairs.
Upstairs, downstairs. Reflections in Water Relief.
Oh yeah, and then Fat Cat turned into a gay bar too.
Yeah, there were a lot of them. You had to send many more options.
Deceptions, or what was the name of that?
Deceptions.
Yeah, right.
I used to call it Rejections.
But what did you ask? Was there?
Were there any like downtown Albany, like where?
Not that I recall, like you know Pearl Street.
Yeah, I don't remember of any
bars down there.
I don't remember. There might have been, but I don't. I never forget if they were there.
That's a shame because it has a lot of potential, especially now.
Yeah.
It has a lot of potential, but I already know how they give it up there. They don't really want that down there. So.
Oh no, you know they don't want a cabaret down there or anything.
No,
like that, you know,
so. And they're missing out on a lot of opportunity.
When I first came out. Because see, we're going back a ways. You know, I had a friend of mine. Now he's white. He's a white guy. We are good friends, and his name was Jeff, and he had a partner. And when I first started, you know, when I first came out. He kind of, I was working at the VA at that time, and he he and I kind of vibed, so that's how, and he, you know, we became friends, and then, that's how I got, sort of connected with the Pride Center and what the Pride Center was and what the Damien Center, what they were, all that kind of stuff. Well, it was always in the same place, you know, the Pride Center was always over there on Hudson Ave, over there, when I got introduced to it. And we, you know, we would go over there, they would have movie nights, we would go over there and see the movie nights, and then that's how I found out about our spaces, our queer spaces, like the Waterworks and those type of places, and across the street were Rocks, well, it wasn't called Rocks back then, but yeah, over there, those bars, basically, different businesses on Lark Street, you know, like O Bar, let's see. What's the? I can't remember the name of the tattoo shop. All that, but yeah, that's how I had gotten introduced to the Pride Center. Was like through a friend that I was working with at the time. And you know, he and I, you know, we clicked off and we vibed. You know, we even fooled around a little bit. You know, we were friends, but we just fooled around. It wasn't anything serious. And he took me around, and I went to the Pride Center. Sometimes I'd go there and we'd see movies and stuff. And then other times, I think I went there for. It had something to do with sexual awareness or something they were having. I went. But after that, shortly after that, though. Okay, now, if I remember correctly, once I had gotten introduced to the Pride Center and you know, start showing up on the sets like the Waterworks and 77 or Rocks, it was the name of the address over here on Central Avenue, Dare and O'Bar and, you know, people, I guess, once I actually started showing up there, people who were actually connected to Black and Latino people of color, Black, you know, people of color, like Jamocha, things like that. Once I showed up on, you know, once Capital Pride put me out, you know, I went to the Pride Center and I went out. And once I got started going to the Waterworks, you know, it's, you know, the Black community, that's how they found out that I was gay.
After I came out, my mom, actually, she told me about the Pride Center and the groups that they had, and she gave me the information. I went by one day, and I can't remember who it was that I had saw there at the time, but they told me about the groups that were there, and I started going to the youth group. At the time, the youth group it was interesting because it wasn't really a youth group. It was more like a young adult group, but they labeled it a youth group. It was for people who were 20 and under and everything. And it was all right. Like, it was all right. It wasn't nothing special. And I met some cool people there. One of them I still talk to this day, but it was all right. But it really wasn't my thing. Like, I just wasn't feeling it. And it wasn't until I ran into an old schoolmate that went to the men's group, not the youth group, but the men's group at the Pride Center. And they were friends with the coordinator. And, you know, that was where I found the men's group. And at the time, the men's group back then was a little different than what it is now. When I was involved with the Pride Center and everything, I remember certain things that they used to do that I had, like, because, you know, my experience wasn't always bad. I had some good moments in the earlier years, you know, like I discovered the men's group, and at the time the men's group was really great. Like, I loved the men's group. I remember, you know, again, it was like always something we look forward to every Monday. I remember, you know, we did so much together. It was just fun. Like, it was always fun, and it was heavily attended. Like I said, I was the youngest one there, you know, but it was very, you know, it was packed in the room. And I remember we did a fundraiser where we wanted to, you know, do stuff for the men's group. We wanted to, you know, go out, or, you know, like, not out to bars or anything. We wanted to, like, kind of do outings. We wanted to, you know, put on events and whatnot. And so we did a fundraiser where we called on community, you know, performers and everything to, you know, raise funds for, you know, the men's group. And I remember we had Jay McBride, who is an openly trans comedic from the Capital Region, who I freaking love. She's funny as fuck. We had Sandy Beach, who is a comedian. She's open lesbian. I haven't seen her in years, but we had her. She's fucking amazing. We had Filipina and Angel South come to the perform doing drag. We had some other people. We had singers and everything, but it was fun, and it was great to see community come together, and it was stuff like that we used to do. The Pride Center used to do Sunday suppers. They used to do all these organizations do so many things, and they were so much fun because it brought the community together, and we had a lot of fun. We got to talk and everything.
When I was at the Pride Center, we started to expand to have some of those programs more in other locations, so Schenectady, I think eventually Saratoga, so that we were actually reaching more of the youth in the 10 county coverage space that the Pride Center has. I think that things like those drop-in programs, the support groups, and things like the prom, I helped James start the kind of weekend-long youth retreat that happened at Lawson Lake. We did that for a couple years. Those programs, and I'm gonna say this as a young person who grew up in a program like that in Maine, like, those programs kept kids alive. And I think having dedicated queer and trans youth spaces is so important to supporting the needs of those young people when they may not have it somewhere else, and even if they do. So I really enjoy getting to kind of dip in and support James's programming with the youth at the Pride Center, because it fed me. Like, it fed my soul and kind of brought me back to my origins in doing this work. So if I can try to remember all of this, we had a couple of gender-based, like, support groups. So we had a women's group, we had a men's group. Those groups were always open to trans folks, though I wanted to make it more explicit after I arrived. We had a trans support group as well. We had our vintage pride group, which worked with our LGBTQ elders. And that was, I think, the kind of cornerstone of that was a monthly potluck. And, you know, we would run some one-off events here and there. So I remember I was able to do, like, a kind of sex education for adults workshop where people came to the center. And I think, you know, we had this, like, regular programming, but also those one-offs that our staff could lend their personal backgrounds and skills to made it unique, made it different. Oh, and there was one of the cool things about the center was that before the third floor was renovated for offices, the third floor used to be a gallery space. And so local artists would show their artwork there, and it would be open during art walk, First Friday art walk, I can't remember. And even after that space was renovated up there, it actually became more accessible to access the art that we had on the first floor. Even though there's still a bunch of steps up to that, it was better than climbing two flights of stairs. And so having artwork around from local artists on a monthly rotation, having a big
library of queer and trans related books. Those were other resources we were able to provide to the community and also showcase our community in. Now, I will also say, I believe that queer and trans libraries and nonprofits should always be updated regularly, because there's some old stuff in there at this point that is outdated enough that it would concern me to have out in the public.
When I first came to In Our Own Voices, when I first came, that was around the time that I had met Jonathan. Jonathan Lang. You know, I met him around that time, and they would have the Department of Health would be down at the riverfront. They would have the health expos and all like that down there, and those kind of things. That's how I really got introduced to In Our Own Voices, was from those kind of social events that they would have. Which, you know, it's good, and I think, you know, there should be more of those. We need the community to have, we need the support of the community behind those kinds of things.
So, In Our Own Voices was founded in 1998. A lot of this you can find in our website. And it was founded, so let me back up. That's when In Our Own Voices received its 501c3 status. But In Our Own Voices, you know, was doing work way before that. And it grew out of four social justice groups. FAN, the Feminist Action Network, Vicki Smith, and you had Cordell Boone and some other founders that was involved in SABLE, Sisters and Brothers in the Life. And then you had JAMOCA, Gay Men of Color Alliance, that was Harry Davis. And then later they were joined by the Social Justice Center.
So, I was on a board of directors, it was called Holding Our Own, a Fund for Women, and their mission was to, it was a lesbians of color led organization. For better or for worse, not everybody was thrilled with that idea. And so we would give money to organizations, startup organizations, that also were lesbian of color led, which was rare in the 80s. And we were like one of the only kind of foundations that were funding projects like that, in part because those projects weren't necessarily all, you know, sign a dotted line, cross your T's, dot your I's. They weren't all 501c3. Some of them were just like startups, and we gave money to those organizations. And one of them, I don't remember exactly, but, you know, In Our Own Voices was, you know, there was definitely a need because the Pride Center was highly problematic, as it still is. And, you know, folks of color, you know, queer black folks and queer people of color did not find what they needed at the Pride Center. It was a no-brainer for us to fund that.
Sometimes when people speak about LGBTQ plus communities, it's easy to kind of paint us with one broad stroke and not look at the diversity and the different nuances that exist within our community. And we were founded to address social and health disparities that were hitting us different, disproportionately impacting Black, Indigenous people of color who were also LGBT. You know, we care about marriage equality, we care about repealing Don't Ask, Don't Tell in the military, we care about, you know, surrogacy and adoption. We see all of those issues are very important, but we're like, what about the health disparities that are impacting us different as Black and brown LGBTQ plus folks? What about domestic violence, sexual violence, hate violence, and crimes that disproportionately impact our Black and brown LGBTQ plus folks and our trans folks of color as well? So those issues weren't given as much importance or the same kind of platform. And also our communities weren't seeing ourselves represented in spaces. We weren't seeing ourselves as executive directors or represented in our legislature or anywhere else. So we were like, if they're not gonna create a space for us to have our voices heard, we're going to create a space, quote unquote, in our own voices. So we were founded to really provide safe space, resources, leadership development, etc., for LGBTQ plus BIPOC communities.
So when I arrived, I definitely had people fill me in on some of the history of the Pride Center. And I think that's important in any new nonprofit job, is to understand kind of the shoes that you're stepping into and what history you are representing. So as I was told, right, as I understand it, the Pride Center, for being the oldest continuously operating center in the nation, which is a really fantastic claim, also had a pretty homogenous start to it. And as it was told to me, the Pride Center didn't do a great job of supporting communities of color, which is why we saw In Our Own Voices start. And as it was told to me, it wasn't doing a great job of supporting women, which is why the women's building and became Holding Our Own started as well. So we had these other organizations that sprouted out of this really difficult history. And so for me coming into that position, I knew that there was going to be an understandable automatic mistrust of a new person, a white person, and somebody who's not a woman in this community. And so it felt really important for me to naturally and genuinely build the relationships on a personal level and in a way that would really benefit particularly both the Pride Center and In Our Own Voices. And so myself and James Schultes, who was later became another director, and Rosie Galvan, I think the three of us, along with a number of other staff supporting, we really tried to make an effort to rebuild trust, knowing that that is a slow and difficult process. And I think that there was progress made. And that's never going to erase whatever pain and history is there. So as an individual, it's difficult coming into a position like that, knowing that I cannot escape the history that I'm holding with me.
We still face a lot of opposition. And in a sense that there's one thing as an organization to have a particular focus on BIPOC, Black, Indigenous people, and people of color, LGBTQI plus folks. And then there is the other thing of having to be a Black lesbian woman that's in leadership. And up until recently, one of, you know, I was for many years the longest standing Black lesbian within the country that has been in leadership. And now we have Carla Smith that's at the center. And amazing addition. So I think that the beginning was so very much blatant, targeted racism, and built within a system that only represented it and only honored and rewarded white gay men. And somewhat we're still kind of operating in that, but the thing of operating under that, which is not unusual, you know, which for power lies, if you look at white privilege, it is that we have so many community and young folks and allies, and including white allies and allies across the board, that recognize the injustices that are happening and, in a sense, are standing on the front lines and using their voices and their bodies, which is amazing. I think when I first started in 2005, coming in with an idea, with a, you know, a hopeful idea of wanting to make sure that we had a seat at the table, but we also, because there's one thing to have a seat at the table, but there's also another thing to have a voice at the table, and then there's another thing to have a decision-making voice at the table. So often we would be, you know, I would be invited to tables after major decisions were made. And that still kind of somewhat happens today, but not as much as it did then. I think we have made a lot of great strides towards the opposition, but we still get, why two prides? Why do you need a BIPOC organization? Why do you need all of these things? And some of it for me is easily you know, explained, and you can use it as education tools. But some of it is really a that speaks to what is happening right now within our country, which is just this really push to uplift only white voices, and everything else doesn't really count, and to continue to oppress others. And so that's not, you know, that we're not, you know, immune to the fact that there is diversity within our community. We're not immune to the fact that racism exists within the LGBT community, and we often are the brunt end of that. I think what we're doing now is making sure that, and you know, with George Floyd and the unrest and social and civil unrest, that more folks are really aware. And a part of your documentary here is doing just that. Talking about these painful histories, talking about the impact that it has had on our community, and it still has that impact on our community. We are still so much divided right now, and that division really lies in power.
But the Pride Agenda started as a merging of two organizations, and forgive me, I don't have that at my fingertips, because I came to the Pride Agenda probably 20 years after they started, maybe 15. But it was a merging of two organizations, a downstate kind of activist organization and an upstate political organization. And so those two organizations merged, and that's how we got this statewide Pride Agenda, Empire State Pride Agenda. You know, their mission was to, I guess, was to pass legislation that would protect, you know, queers, the LG community back then, the LGBT community, right, the LGBTQ, LGBTQ plus, but, you know, back in the day when Pride Agenda started, it was the gay community, right? Gay and lesbian was even a challenge. So that's how that started, and then, again, I don't remember the exact year that it started, but they did have a couple of wins in the beginning of the century, 2002, I think. They had one of their first wins. They had smaller wins around 9/11 in terms of being able to take ownership of your partner's remains. You know, after 9/11, there were queer people who were dealing with no laws protecting us, and so the Pride Agenda was instrumental in kind of addressing that stuff because nobody else was. So there was this employment protections legislation that left the trans community out, and by the way, there were trans people involved in that, and so it was a very painful time for the trans people that were on the board of the Pride Agenda to be part of a conversation where they were told, listen, you guys gotta wait, let us pass this legislation without you, and then we'll come back for you. And 18 years later, we finally passed legislation that protected trans people in employment. So, you know, I think that just a little context, the Pride Agenda had three big bills that we were working on from like 2000, let's say 5 to 2012, 15. That was Dignity for All Students, GENDA, the Gender Expression Non-Discrimination Act, and Marriage Equality. Marriage equality was the funder, right? Rich, white, cis, gay men had a lot of money. They wanted to be able to marry each other so that they could do what marriage laws do, which is pass property and pass wealth to your spouse, which is as it should be. Not moneyed queer people, marriage equality was very important to be able to protect your family, to be able to have health insurance from your partner, be able to protect your children, you know, those types of things, to be able to access your partner who may be in a hospital, those very important things that don't have to do with property and money. But because marriage equality was such an important piece to be able to get funding for the Pride agenda, it became this kind of runaway train that was very important to a particular faction of our a very diverse community. And so the other bills that would have addressed protections for trans people, that would have addressed bullying in schools, kind of an afterthought. We weren't really as activist-y about those bills as we were for marriage equality, because that's where the money was, and no matter what field you're in, or what organization you work for, it's all about the funding, and how do we get more funding. So you can't raise a lot of money by trying to, couldn't raise a lot of money by trying to protect trans people. It just wasn't happening. You had to talk about marriage equality, marriage equality, marriage equality. And so for me, this is my opinion, that was the problem. That was the shift. Focusing on the most well-off in the community to make sure that they can marry each other and then pass wealth back and forth, as opposed to the most marginalized members of the community who really needed us to be advocating in a way that we were not. The Pride agenda was not. And so because there was so much, try not to talk with my hands, because there was so much involvement of cis white gays and lesbians, once marriage equality passed, everybody was like, okay, cool, we're good now. We're good, we got our marriage equality. Sure, we'll be helpful for gender, give me a call. And people just kind of fell away. And at the same time, the board of directors of the Pride agenda was predominantly cisgender, predominantly white. The staff was predominantly cisgender and predominantly white. There were some trans people on staff. They were not in positions of power, or they didn't have any, you know, authority. They didn't have any input. And so it made it really kind of easy to not prioritize that. There were people who were saying, hey, you guys have to prioritize this, but it just didn't happen because it wasn't a diverse enough board, it wasn't a diverse enough staff, and we were a bunch of privileged, predominantly white people, you know, trying to talk about trans justice by learning the talking points as opposed to living it. So
working under this administration has actually given me the platform that I need in the community. And it's not just networking. I also have conversations on policy, on what that looks like for our community. Since I've been working for this administration, the governor signed recently in Gay Pride a safe haven bill, which is to protect anyone from out of state that comes into New York State to seek gender-affirming care and to be protected. And so that's where the safe haven bill came from. We also allocated a funding of $20 million to the Trans Wellness Equity Fund, which is actually named after Lorena Borja, who was a fierce leader and advocate in our community, who passed away from COVID. And this funding is gonna be able to provide the services that the trans community needs. This funding will be going to trans-specific led organizations, and of course the rest of the chunk will go to organizations that provide the services to the trans community. When the governor assumed position as our 57th state governor, she made it clear that she loves the trans community. She will do whatever she needs to do to make sure that the trans community feels safe overall, is being seen, and is being heard. I mean, she recently signed off on the first trans employment data that I believe is gonna be launched pretty soon, which is a data that's gonna collect surveys from trans women who are in the workforce, and they wanna know the experience. We wanna know the experience of how it is to work. Have you experienced any discrimination? Are you being treated fairly? What's going on? So this is gonna be a crucial survey for us to be able to elevate and, you know, protect the trans community more.
So the first time I discovered Waterworks, this is actually a funny story. So I was 20. Now again, this is back in 2014. I was 20 years old, and I remember I was interested in wanting to know what the nightlife was, because you know, my sister and their friends, they're older than me. They were going out and everything, and I was like, I wanna go out, you know, bitch, take me. But I wasn't 21 yet, and I don't remember who told me about Waterworks, but they were like, why don't you try Waterworks? Waterworks is 18 and up. And I remember I called, and I asked, I was like, hey, I heard that you guys are 18 and up. I just want to confirm that and everything. And they were like, yeah, we're 18 and up. You can, you know, come and stuff like that. And so I went, and I remember the first night I went, it was a Monday. And at the time, there was a bartender who I freaking love. His name was Brian. Brian was bartending, and Brian is just, like, even still today, he's a beautiful person. And not just physically, you know, his looks, but his soul, his personality, how he talked to patrons. He was so cool. You had Brian there bartending, and then you had Billy. Billy wasn't working that day, but Billy was on the, was at the end of the bar. And I went there, and I was like, you know, hey, I'm fairly new to the community, and, you know, I'm just trying to figure out, you know, my way. And they were like, welcome and everything. They were just so nice to me. They told me about all the different things that was going on at Waterworks. So they had what we know as Therapy Thursdays. Now, Therapy Thursdays back then was completely different than what Therapy Thursdays is now. Back then, at Waterworks, Thursdays, Fridays, and Saturdays were the days you come out to party, okay? Those were the prime days, okay? And when we would come out for those Thursdays, Fridays, the place was packed, okay? When they say it was the premier gay bar, it literally was. And also at the time, we were, and when I say we as LGBTQ people, we were the majority in our space. It was actually a gay bar then, you know? Not like it is now. And that's no shade, it's the truth. But Waterworks was so different. I remember Therapy Thursdays had different themes and events, and it was hosted by DJ Sean Gilley.
Like, it was the heyday, like, it was amazing. It was nice because I feel like downstairs, the music was always a little bit more urban, and so that we kind of had our space, kind of not, but still. But it was always a fun time. Back then, like, we had so many places to go, and like, it wasn't necessarily, like, I don't think I was ever fully worried about being hate crimes, honestly. Like, that wasn't fully something I ever worried about. It might be because I'm 6'4" and a big black man, but still. And so, like, PSP and all these places, City Beer Hall, like, going there and being queer, it wasn't that big of a deal. I'll never forget Therapy Thursdays, coming up on a Thursday night, getting obliterated and doing all these wild contests. I think the contest is probably the one thing that I miss the most, is that they used to do...
What was your favorite one?
I won the twerking contest a few times, so, like, I definitely was like, we're here, like, I was fully, like, because I had lost 165 pounds when I started coming out, so, like, I had just been like, oh, I'm cute, oh, it's different, it's giving, so, like, any time to be on, like, oh, you want me to twerk? I got you. Like, that probably had to be a favorite, because it was just, like, everyone, and they didn't care what you looked like, it was just like, okay, we're going to be out here. Actually, strike that, my favorite one is the titties contest, and that's because I lived for when they would freak out because you're not supposed to show a nipple at the bar, and they and no one would ever listen, and that was the funniest shit to me, because I was like, girl, I don't want to see no titties, but also at the same time, this is hilarious, like, every single time it happened, and I was like, y'all know she gonna whip out the nipple, the D cup came out, you know she's whipping out the nipple. And every time she did, and they were like, oh my god, no nipples, reminder, no nipples, we can't, you will be disqualified. It was every time, and I loved it.
I loved it, loved it, loved it.
Therapy Thursdays was a ritual. Like that, you just knew it was lit on Therapy Thursdays. I miss that. Me and my best friend, Kimante, he had the nerve to ask me about that. It wasn't recently, but he asked me about that. And I'm like, child, what? But no. But the Eagle parties and a lot of the drag events. Back then, you know, and still now, but there was a lot of richness in the drag culture. And Waterworks and Rocks, it was so authentic. I mean, when I say authentic, them girls were authentic. And we had a lot of root girls that were so unproblematic that used to come like through the Eagle party. Shout out to Isis. I love Isis. Isis is great, heavily misunderstood. And I pray that Isis sees this and feels my energy, because I never forget people who seen me. Because a lot of people looked at me and thought it was a joke. But for those who actually took the time to actually see me, I will never forget that. And Eagle parties, I actually performed for, you know, it was legendary. And a lot of great people used to grace those stages who are not here anymore. Some have passed away, a lot of people moved away. I miss it, you know. Oh, and the Fuse Box. The Fuse Box also had a few nights. They used to do, they had more frequent, like, than what they do now. A lot of, like, it was the Fuse Box, it was the O-Bar. O-Bar was more like a chill set. Chill, but, like, we used to cut up in there in the back, though. But see, like, for me, when I used to go out, I was a young one coming out. So I used to be just, like, I wasn't really deep rooted into like the full swing of things. I was only like service, going out to get drunk and carry on with the girls and just be a mess. But I am happy that I was able to experience, you know, parts of the O-Bar, Fuse Box, a lot of the parties, back in the early 2010s at Rocks. I used to headline at Waterworks. I was still in high school, performing on stage, underage, and I was kicked out. There, I was headlining, I was hosting Wednesday shows. This was before Filipina and Gemini, and when they found out, they said, oh, Dan, me and Dan had it out for each other for years. I'm so happy that we're on good terms now and that he lets me in the club, because child, he did not let me in that club for years. And it was so crazy because I was headlining and everybody knew me, and it was just, but you know, when you're young, you make stupid decisions and stuff and just be silly and all that stuff like that.
I got introduced to drag here in the capital region by my drag mother, Gemini De Barbe. And when I started doing it, I was just like, oh my god, am I ready to swim on a bigger pond this time? But like at the same time, challenges always comes in life. So I just dove into the craft of it. And that's how I got introduced in the capital region and drag scene. So I'm gonna tell you this story right now. I was a little young boy who's only 17 and started going in drag. And we got there early. And since then, I just started doing it. Nobody ID'd us before. It was all good times, all about sisterhood and all about the craft. So I think that's the best part of my life, getting introduced about the craft and drag. And since then, I just started doing it. And I just fell in love with it.
I was in high school, and part of our GSA group, we would attend galas and all forms of dances and whatnot with my school, Roundout Valley. And I noticed one drag queen there who was holding these big signs around for the gala. I forgot what part it was for. And that turned out to be my drag mother, Isis Vermouth, all the way from Poughkeepsie. And that's when I first got a glimpse of drag, and I got to ask my fellow peers and even my mother, who's a big fan, afterwards what a drag queen was. And from then on there, it just started becoming an interest of mine. looking into celebrity impersonation and whatnot. And I found Miss Isis Vermouth online and started chatting them up and studying drag on my own time besides school. And when I graduated high school, the evil drag queen themselves, Isis, invited me up to Albany to the ego parties at Rocks, and I was just 18 years old. We were playing off, I was 21, like I'm sure everybody else. But that was my introduction to the Albany nightlife and queer community as well. The ego party is funny, touching back on Isis Vermouth, my drag mother. She started that party, I don't know how many years ago, but through my drag grandmother, which is her drag mom, Lady Estrogen. She was getting really annoyed with Isis when they were running the scene in Kingston a long time ago. And she told Isis, you know, you have a really big ego. And Isis says, well, fuck it, I'm making it the ego parties. And I think that ran from different bars around. But the purpose of the ego party, I think, was to have fun with that ego and to really celebrate the fantasy of drag, the fantasy of nightlife, put some glitter on yourself and be whoever the hell you want to be. And I think that's what it really, that's the whole point of it. We haven't done the parties in a while. It's been a few years. It's many guests from New York City, Brooklyn especially, the girls who run the Bushwick drag variety festival down there in Bushwick, like Harchata, Mary Cherry, Untitled Queens were some favorites of mine. We've had queens come up from Texas, Florida, California, Canada probably. Sure, they're from all over the place. We even had Amanda Lepore, that bitch was fun. Sharon Needles, like Drag Race girls as well. We've had two of my favorite ones were definitely Amanda Lepore and Sharon Needles. That was a party. Could not move around in that place, that's for sure.
Well, I'll never forget, I messaged Cece LaRue because we were friends. I'm friends with Daryl. And I was like, hey girl, you got a spot for a new girl in one of your shows? And she was like, no way. She's like, absolutely. And she's like, okay, come on out. That was back when I was called Bigfoot. I was called Les Pieds Grandes. That was my drag name because I'm a size 16 foot. And I was like, it's a pun, it's funny. It's also something that drag queens can't say once they get drunk. Like, Les Pieds Grandes, coming to them. And I'm like, I'm not French. Like, why did any of these things really go together? Who knows? But that was back, yeah, I was Bigfoot, and I was so excited, and I rehearsed. I put months of time and energy into, like, taking videos of me rehearsing and meeting all these people, and, like, I got a choreographer. Like, it was no small feat. Like, I was gonna do it really big. And I did it, and it was amazing. I loved, like, everything about what being in drag was, and, like, the fact of, like, it was very liberating, because you're just, like, you're creating another character, so it kind of gives a whole different light to you, so like that was great. And then they asked me like, oh, do you want to do it again? And I was like, sure, why not? I made pretty good money the first time because like capitalism, we're all like, okay, money talks, like let's do it. Did it again, made great money, did it a third time and was like, I gotta change his name. and my good Judy Serotonin actually named me. And so she gave me the name More Glamazon through a Facebook chat, and one of the groups there was like, girl, you can't, this name, we gotta figure something out. And she's like, well, what do you love about drag? I was like, I love glamour. And mind you, everything I was wearing was from Burlington. Burlington Coat Factory was glamour for me, More Glamazon was the house down.
RuPaul definitely gave the biggest impact before, because we look up to the girls who was on TV, because, you know, think about the girls who was on TV around, they used to be a local girl. Then now they have a platform to spread their craft and stories around the world. They became international. And probably once you get booked with a RuPaul, you're the it girl now, or the shit, but like at the same time, people don't realize that those girls before were nobody like us. And suddenly people are just supporting the RuPaul girl that was on TV and forgetting about the local girls who actually put works to put the capital region on the map. So a kind of like a bittersweet story, but like it is what it is. But I hope one of these days one of the capital regions queens will get on the show, and hopefully everybody support that queen, whoever that may be, and put it on the map and support each other.
Who were some of the, I want to say, premier queens that were known around here that were kind of doing the shows and performing
the big
a lot?
Queens around here at that time, out of all of them, A Box of Vine was one of my biggest favorites. I don't think I'd honestly be as good as I am if it weren't for A Box of Vine, who's the first drag queen I saw at the Hugo parties, who did a mix, a drag mix, and I had no ideas those were a thing, that you could make it comedy, and I believe it was a Christmas show too. She did a Mariah Carey, All I Want for Christmas, and it cut, I'll never forget it, and went into Kesha, Boots and Boys, Boots and, I was cracking up, and I was just floored. Never seen anything like it. I started making mixes after them too, and then that put my name on the map right after. Another big queen, Civil Service. Civil Service is by far the most artistic and creative one I've seen, from props to mixes to looks. It was all, it was very well done. I miss her, I wish she was still around more. Other queens, Chardonnay Lettice, big, big one, may she rest in power. That lady. She would decorate the whole clubs for any theme party. She did, what is it? Burlesque on the Rocks. It was her big burlesque show at Rocks, obviously. And even for my birthday once, she decorated the whole bar for me. And you could walk into the whole place and not even recognize where you were. She went as far as throwing, my birthday's in Halloween, she threw leaves all over the ground inside the club. I was falling, but it looked great. Those are some good three. Oh, how can I forget about Piff? She was a freaking treat. Everybody loved Pacifica. She was a big, big fan favorite. She was fun, she was flirty, she was catty. She was like Albany's little Disney princess. She really was. Jacqueline. I didn't think she would keep up with the white makeup every time. I thought at some point she would just like change it and be, you know, flesh tone, baby. Yeah, Mr. Two, she was fun. She did so many like really cool light tricks, and that was very intriguing and got me very dizzy. But she was a hoot.
Katarina Mirage, who was
That's
still around.
My girl. She's still my girl. After all these years, we're doing so many shows together still. We talk plenty. You know, I definitely stayed in touch with her. We started together. Started drag together. Her, Filipina, myself. Well, I think those are the two closest I've been to since I started this. Kasia Goleen, too, of course. That monster. That's my best friend. She is a monster. But she is is the only drag queen that got as far as they did regarding like getting on like Drag Race. She did all these music videos, find them on YouTube, they're still there. Oh my gosh, I was in a couple too, you know, sure. Kasia Goleen.
You had Coco Kane.
Coco Kane, my favorite pointer sister. She was running the Diva Dolls at Waterworks for a while there. When I started coming up here, I would crash at Kashi and London's place. They lived together. You know, that was hilarious too. All the ginger aleses. Yeah, everybody was just kind of starting out and looked terrible at the time. We all looked bad. But we were good.
So, do you remember the nights that it was the most popular to come out for Waterworks?
I personally, for me, it was always Thursdays because the music was better. It wasn't techno music upstairs. It was
3 nights. Thursdays was the first, Fridays, and then Saturdays. Those were your most popular nights.
Oh yeah, the full weekend.
Yes, but definitely Thursdays. Mm-hmm. Thursdays used to be packed. Mm-hmm. Actually, all three nights were packed, but Therapy Thursdays within itself was where...
It had its own entity. Like, it had its own energy, because you could go on another day, and it was great, but it just wasn't therapy. And like, because I'll never forget, being like, yeah, we're going to go out. And I was like, you go out on Thursdays? And I was like, yeah, come on out, let's do it. And then they saw it, and they're like, I get it. And like, it was like when therapy... And it was therapy when it was just that water, because whenever therapy was at fucking Fuse Box, with the dirt floor, girl, my outfit is too cute to be walking on this dirt floor. The bar was cute though, the little like 70s bar, little retro diner bar, Waterworks definitely, it was just, you would always go, it was always popping, and I felt like I was always meeting someone new, honestly, even though you would see the same people. Like, there's a point at which I became a regular, and I was like, damn, girl, I'm here too much. But, like, you still always met someone new and different, and it brought people from so many cities. Like, the New Pulse people would come up, like, people would come down from wherever. Like, it was the spot, like, for gays within probably a 3-hour span, like, or 2-hour span. Like, it was the spot. If you were anywhere within 2 hours of Waterworks, that was probably the best gay bar you had for you. So like, come on through. Oh my God, yeah, no, I had so many nights there. Like I probably have, if you look at the old therapy pages, you could find, I love doing that, finding yourself in the old pictures. Oh my God, being like, I remember that. Like, it was a time.
Mm-hmm. Now where would you say the change happened with our gay spaces?
So I think the biggest change is PSP closed, which was the biggest straight space, especially in a college city, because at this point we are a college city and we have 1-3 colleges within us, and then we have like probably 6 colleges around us, like all within maybe a 15 to 20 minute drive at most if you like are far out. So like, when PSP closed, it was like, the kids were like, where are we gonna go? And Waterworks at the time still maintained their 18 and up. So it was like, okay, they're like, oh, we're coming here. Because like, it's the best space. Like they play the best music, they have a dance floor. And I don't know why Rocks doesn't get any of the spillover. I don't know why, like, I still to this day could not, like Rocks is on the come up, they're on the comeback. But if you look on a busy, busy night where there's a line, people would rather be in the line at Waterworks than be inside Rocks. Straight, gay, indifferent. And I don't really know why that is. Like, it doesn't fully make sense to me, because I'm like, oh, you mean there's a space with music that, like, I don't have to wait in this long-ass line out in the cold in the dead of winter? But bitches will be waiting in the Waterworks line in the cold and dead of winter. But that was the big the big shift for me, because then it felt like the queers weren't the priority. We were not, because we were not making them as much money as the straights. Because now there's all the, I mean, granted, you need to do upgrades, but like, we have all these upgrades, which is lovely, but why did we have them before? Because our money was just as green as everyone else's, like, and we damn straight packed the house. So like, but it was just interesting. But no, it's definitely become a straight bar, and it's interesting that we, because the kids, I think 21 and younger, or 23 and younger, I feel like, and it's gonna sound weird, but I feel like all the kids are queer. Everyone's just like, love is love, which I think is beautiful. But instead of just like, being an ally, everyone is queer, even if you're not really queer. And that's probably gonna sound really problematic, but that's, I feel like, the direction we're going, and so it leads us, older generations, to feel like our space isn't just ours. Because you can always recognize a queer person. Like, I feel like, granted, everyone looks different, everyone has a different cadence, they exist differently within their queerness, but like, I can look at you and be like, okay, that, and so you can, not that that's always the gauge every single time, but still, like, it's just like, okay, it doesn't leave the space to feel as comfortable as it used to be, because it doesn't feel like it's just for us, and there was a while where a lot of the white girls in the drag scene were like, we have to stop telling the queers to go home, or the straights to go home. And I'm like, we're not actually telling them to go home, but they don't create, they don't respect the space that they have entered. And so it's kind of a lot of work and a lot of labor on us. And I was like, and I'm like, you don't understand, because this is your first time having to explain life to somebody else, especially if you are a queer white person that has had a semi-easy moment. For us, it was really quicker for the, I feel like a lot of the POCs to be like, bitch, this is annoying already. We're already over it. Because like, imagine having the labor of explaining to people black culture all the time. And then you're explaining to people queer culture all the time. And now I have to explain queer culture in my queer space all the time. That's too much work for me. And I don't want to have to do it in the space that was supposed to be ours.
What was the reason that the ego party stopped?
I think it was just a bunch of falling outs left and right. What you're talking about when it stopped, right? Yeah, there was just a bunch of falling outs going on when I left. I left ego parties. I just was left, you know, the girls, there's drama. There's always going to be drama. Especially when, what is that, my early 20s that was going on? I'm about to be 30 this year, so. Everybody's young, everybody's finding themselves, everybody's also a character in drag. So, you know, you're gonna be catty, you're gonna be living that fantasy still. And there would be just some clashings where it just didn't work out right, and people were not communicating properly, and it just kind of fell out from there. And then, I don't know where Isis was, I think Isis just started working on more projects too, and kind of left a lot of us to run it when she was gone too, and it just kind of like fell through, and you know, people were moving, some people graduating school, you know, people switching it up, and I don't know. I want to say that's the only reason why it fell through. I'm sure there's more that I don't know about. Luckily, Blair back from Poughkeepsie can still carry on some of the traditions that we did at ego parties, like the Dueling Divas, which was always which always got a rise out of anybody. So at least we still have those. But the falling out of ego, it was a shame. It was a shame.
I will say this. Even though I'm mentioning all the fun, colorful stuff, there were things that I was not aware of. There were a lot of things, and I'm talking about the nightlife, in regards to people and individuals respecting people like myself. And I wouldn't learn this until the end of that decade, which would be 2020, about the darkness that actually follows the colors that we perceive when we first see these spaces and places. Now, although beautiful moments were made, I am very aware of the negativity that goes on behind the scenes that affect us all when we go to these places. So I can't mention one without the other. You know, I can't forget and I cannot deny the presence of inequality, racism, and segregation. Let's not say segregation, discrimination. That's a better word, because people still mix and mingle, so there's really no segregating, but there is definitely lots of discrimination. And it's hurtful because you kiki with these people, you know, you laugh over drinks, you cry, you have heart-to-hearts, people see you and they share your struggle. Some people don't share the same struggles, and some people do. But it's just odd to me, and I'll say this point, that we as gay people, we are fighting for our rights from the world, only for us to come into our own community, and we're literally fighting for the same things amongst each other. What on hell is that? Like, what is that? No, like, honestly, like, when you think about it, what is that? Why? Why do I have to feel like I have to be, like I have to be so guarded and like I have to protect myself when I should be in a safe space?
I like to say what my therapist had helped me describe. When I came into this community, I was very disillusioned with how the community was gonna be. I was like, oh my God, I was gonna find my tribe. I was gonna find people who love me. I was gonna find friends and everything. And to some degree, I did find that, preferably when I moved out of Albany. And so when it came to, you know, getting involved in the community, I got in and it started off cool at first. Like I said, I started going to the Pride Center and everything. It was cool for the first year or two. And then slowly but surely, the more I got involved in the community, the more I started to see a lot of the issues, such as racism, colorism, classism, internalized homophobia, transphobia from gay men and other trans people, and you know, so on and so forth. And I'm like, wait, huh? Like, this really exists in a community that is already, you know, not accepted in the world, like, for real? And so, you know, yeah, I actually have faced that a lot. I remember one of the things I remember was, there was a community member of color. I can't remember who the hell they were because they clearly weren't important. But, you know, I just came out, and it was a community of color. My complexion called me a fucking monkey, and they called me a burnt cockroach. And they were like, I would never befriend you and I would never date you. I only date white people. And I only befriend white or light-skinned people, and da 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 da. And I'm like, what? Like, I'm just like, where is this coming from? Because I wasn't flirting with you, wasn't even talking to you or anything. You came up to me, and just all this, and that's like one of many occasions where I've had to deal with, you know, people, you know, being colorist to me because of my skin tone, and even the way that I talk, it was like, oh, you talk white, you act like a white boy, and da da da. And I'm like, so me being well spoken is considered white? I'm like, I can't help the way that I talk. I can't help the way that I am.
I cannot deny the blatant snubs, just like Beyonce has gotten snubbed and Nicki Minaj has gotten snubbed for Grammys, the blatant snub that our black entertainers receive in these spaces, at these places. There should be no reason why we are begging on our knees, metaphorically, to just be present and be allowed to be in certain places that are rightfully ours. Some of the girls really have put in that work. Some of these girls are coming into the scene with privilege and being past things or just giving things just because. And when people watch this video, they're gonna know exactly what I'm talking about. And unfortunately, as popular as I am in this community, I still have a hard time trying to get booked or trying to have people take me seriously when I've proven myself time and time and time and time and time again. But you see how I'm talking about that? Like, what I'm speaking about is fuel for me to be great, because so many people are hoping that you stop. They want us to stop. But why is it that it's like almost like it's okay for people to, and let me say, when I say people, I mean these clubs, I mean these allies who try to book us or who want us to be present in their spaces. Why is it okay for one person to get this and the other person not? They have to work 10 times harder. That's a lot, that happens a lot here. That happens a lot here. And I won't say names, but it's just like, I have one entertainer, I mean, like, blows the socks off my feet. There's no one touching her. And the way that she struggles to even just be taken seriously around here is absolutely wild. And she's been out here for a long time. But it's because of the color of the skin. I really do feel like places like the Pride Center and In Our Own Voices should be doing a lot more when it comes to racism in these places that we have to frequent. There should be a lot more advocating for people of color, just like BIPOC. Why is it that no one has a big buzz about BIPOC, but everybody knows about Sunday? Everybody knows about Pride. Pride is Sunday, but Pride is also Saturday. You have black entertainers coming to put on a show, coming with their vendors, coming to put in work, coming to be a part of something wonderful, a festival. But we're not giving the same attention, money, and time. But yet they get this on the Sunday. That same difference is the same way in Waterworks and Rocks. And hey, I love Waterworks. Yes, I hate certain things that go on there, but you know, it's one of our own spots that we have. So it's like, kind of like you gotta deal with it. But it's like blatant things that are done right in our colored faces that we have to deal with. So even though there have been beautiful moments made at these Eagle parties and at Wasted Wednesday and whatever the case may be, there's still the fact that there is nasty discrimination going on and that it's a joke to the people that are discriminating. And they think that it's funny and that it can keep happening, and it can't, and it won't. Not as long as we keep allowing it. Not as long as we keep making ourselves available to be let down. You can't say yes. I would have already been booked if I took every gig, but for what I'm trying to go for, they're not giving me what I deserve. So it's like, if I do this, I'm settling. And in certain instances, in every instance it's not that way, but I'm telling you the truth. You know what I mean? Albany is a lovely place, but we have a lot to do. We have a lot to do as a community, as far as sisterhood, brotherhood, gays to straights, whatever. It's like a lot of work that needs to still be done.
We obviously know y'all do BIPOC Pride, which once upon a time was Black and Latino, say it loud, Black and Latino Pride.
Yes.
I want to talk about that, but I also want to talk about the other Pride events y'all used to do, such as the Gaily Bowl, the Sober Dance, that you guys still do. I want to talk about, you know, some of the people you had at Pride that a lot of you people don't even remember who was there, such as, what is his name? So that seems McCormick. Samson. I want to talk about some of those people. So.
Yeah, Samson, oh my God. Samson was amazing. You know, we had Crystal Waters, you know. We've had so many amazing artists that have come through, and talent, just amazing talent. And for some, like a Samson, you know, we gave him, you know, a platform that he didn't have with his comedy in the past. And Samson literally reached out, I think it was like in 2010, and said, I just want to do this. I want to be, you know, I'll pay my own way and you don't have to pay me anything. So for years, he attended Say It Loud Black and Latino Gay Pride for free and lent his talent to MCing. I mean, and we had Gaily Bowl that was not a part of Pride. The Gaily Bowl was kind of like a sport, like a relay sport, right? And what that we wanted to do is just look at exercising and the health and have some fun doing it and some competition. I love the Gaily Bowl, by the way. I think we should bring it back. I really want to bring that back. You know, tug of war and, you know, snow cones. It was just a really fun time. So we've had a lot of events. You know, Gay Palo was coined because we wanted to do auditions for our community. And we've always for Pride, we always tapped into our community. And we open up the door for anyone that has a talent or not, but still can be involved. And that's what I like. I really do appreciate it.
The growth trajectory of Pride, Black and Latino Gay Pride, formerly Black and Latino Gay Pride, now BIPOC Pride. Yeah, starting off as a barbecue. Our CEO and other folks in the community have went to DC, experienced DC Black Pride. Because some people think that we're the only place that does it. They're like, why are you doing this? It's separatist. There are Black Prides and people of color Prides throughout the United States and also throughout the world. So it's nothing that we created. However, locally, we didn't have a space that centered our experiences as BIPOC folks. So the original Pride started off smaller scale. We were had a different capacity as an organization at that time. So Washington Park barbecue, small gathering. Then we said, hey, this is kind of gaining some traction. Let's put some more resources and time and effort and into it, and let's see what we can do. Because most folks don't know that BIPOC Pride is an intervention. It's a community level intervention to connect our communities to resources. Our communities are underserved medically. Our communities are underserved when it comes to the criminal justice system, and also overrepresented in the criminal justice system. So the Health and Wellness Expo component of BIPOC Pride is the heart of the event. So we connect communities with health screenings, we connect them with community resources, whether that's DV services, culturally specific services, spiritual services, health and wellness in a holistic, comprehensive way. So that's one of the main components of it. So we continue to grow that theme. And then we of course have entertainment, and our community members come through because it's community led. We have community committees that plan the events. We have auditions where the majority of the participants for entertainment are local. And then we have a couple of headliners for just name recognition and exposure to kind of get more folks in. But it's mostly community-based and community-led. So we outgrew Washington Park and we moved to the riverfront and had a few good years there, had some wonderful events there. We had Vogue Evolution, we had Octavia St. Laurent, we had just Latrice Royale, like these folks who were like pioneers in our communities present at that venue. So I will always have a special place in my heart. As we began to grow and continuously, we outgrew the riverfront. So we went back to where it all began, Washington Park, because it has more of a space. So that's where we are now. And I think the venue is at the heart of Albany. It's accessible. A lot of folks appreciate that venue and that space. So I'm just looking forward to what's to come for that venue.
I remember you guys telling me that they used to splatter paint on the billboards and stuff like that for In Our Voices. I actually remember the specific incident where they ripped up, I think it was the Adina Howard one. Mm-hmm. They ripped it up and sent it in a
envelope
with a Harvey Milk stamp.
Yep.
So when we look at that, you know, most people think, oh, you guys are, you know, one community. Racism still exists. They're shocked at it. I want to dive more into that conversation about racism that In Our Own Voices has faced, discrimination from within the community, etc.
Again, that could be its own documentary. We every year, and you've mentioned it, but every year we've had our Pride materials vandalized. We've had our bus shelter ads marked with permanent black marker over it. We've had paint thrown onto our billboards. We've had our banners slashed. We traditionally will have some banners outside of our office on Lark Street. People have slashed them with scissors and knives. You mentioned everything you mentioned, because you know we face this, you know. And one of the things that I spent my first probably 10 years at In Our Own Voices doing was educating the community, because every time around January when people start talking about Pride, it's like, oh, if we had white Pride, everybody be up in arms, and if we had this is, and you're dividing our community. I've said the only way that BIPOC Pride is divisive is if you choose not to attend, because we make it very clear that it's open to all. it's centering the experiences of LGBTQ BIPOC communities, because we don't always have that. We don't always have our food at the forefront, our music at the forefront, our faces at the forefront. Even in larger scale pride that attempt to be inclusive, we still see ourselves being the minority and not really given that same level of access, attention, or platform. So this really centers the needs of our communities. And then I'm gonna circle back to what I said earlier, that BIPOC pride is also an intervention. Our communities are disproportionately impacted by health disparities, social disparities, etc., when compared to our white LGBTQ plus counterparts. So having this space is bringing attention to that, connecting communities with resources. And we also are aware that our communities are in interracial relationships. They come from blended families, they come from multiracial families. So it's nothing that is intended to be non-inclusive or exclusionary. Everyone is welcome every year. So I spent the first 10 years really going on social media, because it was also mostly on the social media platforms. So I was on there typing up paragraphs and novels, and I got to the point I said, all I can do is educate and provide information, and people can do with that what they want. We can't force people to believe anything or to shift their minds or hearts. So I stopped. I provided basic information. I didn't go as hard and, you know, raise my blood pressure and really say, I gotta convince these folks. No, I don't. We are unapologetic as an organization. We know the purpose. We educate folks on the purpose. And if they choose to realize that and support, then we welcome them. So I would say that is something that shifted slightly around the time of George Floyd and the time of the Black Lives Matter movement. A lot of white folks were like, yeah, I see this. So I said, so how could you be for Black Lives Matter, but then also saying, why are we having a BIPOC pride? So I think it opened up a lot of people's eyes to, yes, there are disparities, yes, there are discrepancies. So a lot of the folks who were kind of like naysayers, anti-BIPOC pride, started attending. They were like, oh, I'm attending my first BIPOC pride this year. So we did see some changes to the larger LGBTQ plus social consciousness around the differences and the barriers that our communities face. So we saw more support. We've been seeing more support since then. Is it where it needs to be? No. We still have the naysayers and the folks who think we should collapse and just do one pride. And it's like, no, pride season goes from May to, I think, October. In different countries, in different states around the United States. So there's space for everybody. You know, there's space to have, you know, a trans pride celebration, then BIPOC pride celebration, then lesbian celebration, then pan. Like, there's enough space. Like, celebrate more. We don't have to limit our celebration, you know. So I'm really hopeful in where we are going, but there's a lot further for us to go.
When you look at pride over the last decade, do you feel that it's changed? In the sense of, like, it don't hit the same anymore?
Which one? Both? Ooh. Or are you speaking about Sunday?
I'm gonna speak to both as a whole. You know, do you feel that they have changed over the course of the decade? And if so, why?
I do not feel that BIPOC has changed much, other than they are beginning to pay their performers, which, great, by the way. I don't see much change. I would actually like to see more improvement so that we could get a bigger turnout, which would mean just good for everybody all around, whether it's monetary or just whatever, outreach, whatever. In regards to the Sunday Pride, there has been change with who they've allowed to perform. I'm aware that not many of the Black girls have been able to perform there, and it's been very hard, and that they don't want too much cultured performances. So after the pandemic, when it was Black Lives Matter, and when I say it like that, I'm not saying that in a way, I'm just doing it because everybody was falsely supporting. It wasn't real. It was just a thing to do, it was a trend, just like everything else. So they I guess they threw together a Black lineup. Sickening, let's give them this. Okay.
then, but once again, you know, we do not have a lot of colored girls being able to perform. That's the only change that I've seen from them was that they incorporated colored performers on their set after the pandemic. That's like the really only change. And I'm a little bitter about that because at the end of the day, everybody should have a shot at main stage. That's almost like, in my opinion, that's a career defining moment for your drag career or an entertainment career in Albany. In the gay scene, you've hit the biggest stage. We're all qualified for that. And the amount of disrespect that the people who run the one on Sunday to black people and colored people behind closed doors that they don't want to talk about, that people act like don't go on, is out of this freaking world. They do not like us. They call us the most nastiest things behind closed doors. But unfortunately, some of us have to deal with it because we want to be on that stage. And that's the crazy part. Knowing that, but still wanting to be here and for the bigger picture, showing representation, having representation for whoever you are, you know what I'm saying? So it's like you gotta bite the bullet, and that's the change I would like to see. That's what I would like to see.
Introduction into the ballroom scene, and which house were you a part of?
So I am still a part of the House of Giovanna. I am the mother of the House of Giovanna. We have an overall mother who brought me into the house by the name of Ladon Sebastian and Paris, who's now an international commentator, traveling the world, commentating balls all over the place. And that happened in 2011, I want to say. I was at Rocks because I'd already been performing, so I was already kind of known. And that particular night, they were there, LaDawn and Paris. And LaDawn brought me over and was like, oh, I have a house named such and such. Would you like to be a part of it? And I was like, I'll come to the meeting. I want to know more about the house, because coming from New York City, I knew, you know, I've been going to balls since I was about 14 years old. Roseland Ballroom, I knew about houses. I was a part of the House of Little LeBlanc when I was working for POCC in Proxville, Brooklyn. So ballroom was always a part of my life. I just didn't know what the ballroom scene was like up here until I was introduced to it through those individuals, and I'm still a part of that house today.
So pre-transition, prior transition, I was the father of the House of Giovanna at one point. Okay, and I will tell you is that, okay, so Albany had no ballroom scene, okay, and Albany had no ballroom scene. So the thing is that there were like other people who tried to have balls in Albany. They were they weren't really successful. Two other people, the icon Mahogany Chanel moved up here to Albany. I don't know if she still lives here, but she had a ball here in Albany. And there were a few participants, and it wasn't really a huge thing, but she did have a ball here. And then Interim Voices did attempt to have a POC ball that they linked up with the people from New York City, and they came up here and tried to throw something, and it was actually people came, but there was no local people that were really able to put on balls and things like that. So with so many new gay children of color, myself and Mother Giovanna, you gotta give Mother Giovanna her props, because she was the one who saw that there was a need to have, it was a need and a want, it was a void that could be filled. She was like, you know, she's a legendary in the House of Chanel, for realness, and she wanted to start to have balls up here in Albany. So she did. I immediately got on board. I wasn't the father at the time, but I helped her. The thing about it is, I'm from Albany. I know a lot of people, so I helped her to promote the ball. So she had this. She got the space. She had a ball. It was a huge, huge, huge success. So many kids came out. So many kids that we didn't even know even existed. Kids from other areas like Syracuse came. It was a big thing. So right then and there, it was a reset for Albany. That ball was a reset for Albany. The house of Giovanna, her pouring into the house of Giovanna and really creating this house with these kids, with these beautiful, talented young kids, did something to, I think it did have something to everyone. It just put a spark that people were seeing, like we were seeing on YouTube, who were knowing about ballroom and senior in Europe. And there were other people who had experience with ballroom, you know. So then they started having their own houses. So Mother Lamia made a house. And she gathered children from Albany. Then you had London J. Precise. She made a house. And she gathered kids from her niche. And everybody got together. And now there was houses. So we actually had other people to battle. The thing is that's clear is that there's only one mainstream ballroom scene. There's only one mainstream ballroom scene, and then there's a Kiki scene. The thing about it is that there's no license for ballroom, so anybody that wants to fucking throw a ball can throw one. That's exactly why ballroom is now mainstream. You have Pepsi throwing a ball, whereas Mary J. Blige is the judge and stuff like that, because the thing about, I mean, those are sponsors, and that's a whole different type of thing, but the thing about it is that it, with no one having to have a license to be able to do this, to be able to create houses, to have a ball and everything like that, it makes it that way anyone can do it. So, to bring it all back to here, so Mother Giovanna did that. So we started throwing balls consistently, maybe twice, three times a year. It was something to look forward to. It was something that people look forward to. And not only that, the straight community was coming too, to Mother Giovanna's balls. Now, I guess, yeah, they do still come, because I'm not going to say, like, people are like, these balls that they have now that are from the agency and stuff like that, they're actually great events, but they're only great events. We have to give Mother Giovanna her props for starting the House of Giovanna, because of what she did, it made so that way it was actually a ballroom scene here to have. So, it's good to see. It did a lot for Albany, I think, the gay scene. It changed the way the kids look at themselves. I think it changed the way they look at each other. Also, these events don't have violent activity that goes on. Not a lot of out there drug activity going on. So they're pretty successful events. And I just think that that's something that will probably exist in Albany for the duration at this point, now that it's going on. Yeah.
So you mentioned two other houses. So I was going to ask you.
Yes.
Apart from the House of Giovanna,
yes,
the House of Encore, and the House of Precise.
Yes.
What were the other main houses here, if there were?
So, so Mother Tara had a house. I don't remember the name. I think it was Milani or something like that. I don't want to disrespect Mother Tara, but she had created a house. And she had some kids in it, and it didn't last long. She did the best she could, I guess, for the situation. But in order to really maintain your house, you really need to need to throw a ball or a mini ball or some kind of event to really get your name out there. At least that's how it worked here. Like, you know, and I don't think she ever was able to ever throw a ball. You know, I know London has thrown a ball or a few, and I know that Lamia has had her name attached or has thrown her own balls and things like that. So, that is the three main real Albany houses would be Giovanna, Encore, and Precise. Those are the ones, when you think of Albany houses, those are the ones, and all different, and all important and significant in what it is that they brought to the table. You know, because the thing about it, if there's no rivalry, if there's no competition, there's no ball. So it was good to see the all three mothers are fierce. I will give it to all three mothers are fierce and had the respect of their kids and loyalty of their kids. You know, and there were also members of the House of Giovanna that left Giovanna to go to those. They were better fits for them to join those houses. And it was history was being made, you know, here in Albany, yes.
What are the houses here now, if you know?
Well, I am the newly upstate mother of the House of Junior Mafia, which was founded by Paris, who was my brother of the House of Giovanna. He was Paris Giovanna. Now he is the mouth of the South, meaning that he is one of the best commentators doing it right now down south. Precise, Rockin', Encore. Okay. And there are probably a couple stragglers that have traveled from New York City. And I, when I say stragglers, I don't mean that in a disrespectful way, but just more, when I say stragglers, like one or two individuals, I can't pick up their names right now. But right now there's a prominent four.
So what do you feel that the balls have changed from then to now? And if so, what do you see that's the change?
So there is a lot of branching off and people creating their own houses, which I think is a great thing, because for a long time I was just like, there are only three houses and we just keep battling the same people. How do we as ballroom community evolve outside of that? And so I think it's really great that other houses are forming and walking and presenting and representing ballroom. But coming from New York City and understanding ballroom, from myself, and I know the House of Giamatti has also been a part of this, if I'm putting on the ball, I shouldn't be walking the ball. I should not be walking a category, because my judges are gonna favor people that are part of that house. And because the community is so small, there's always that kind of push and pull for me when it comes to that, because everyone knows everyone and everyone has their favorites or people that they don't see at all. And so that's always a struggle for me personally. Yeah.
What is your take on having the requirements for participants to be on that judges panel to make it right, to make it fair, but also make it accurate to what ballroom is and how ballroom operates?
Okay. So for me, to be able to be a judge on a judges panel for a ball, you have to have walked a ball. You have to have won a category. You have to have an understanding of what ballroom is, and not just a Kiki Lounge judge, but an actual major mainstream ball, or a few, to be on a judge's panel. Because you have to have an understanding of what ballroom is. And if you're just a person that has been to a couple balls, maybe walked one or two balls, do you think you have the right skills to accurately judge someone else? Do you think you have the understanding of what ballroom is, what houses actually are, what they started as, the history of ballroom? All these things need to be factored in when you're asking a person to be a judge. Do they have a history of ballroom? Do they know what chants are? Do they know what a commentator is? Do they know why categories are so specific in their ask? If not, why are you judging?
I can't speak for anyone else, I'll speak for myself. So, you know, I was going through a lot internally within myself. So with that came drug addiction. You know, it's been a part of my history for a very long time. And the demon of addiction came back to get me. And she almost had me. So I went on a 7-year drug spree for 7 years. Within that time also, because of a lot of things I was going through mentally, a lot of conflict I was going through internally, I did make the bold decision to follow my heart's desire and transition into who I am today, which is Lisa. And is the best decision I've ever made for myself. I don't regret making that decision. I'm very happy that I made the decision. When you transition, there's no way any person, I believe anybody that's gonna transition, that's gonna take their transition seriously, that's really gonna do what it takes to make a transition happen from male to female, that's all I can speak about because that's what I'm living, has to make sacrifices. And so one of the sacrifices that I made was, is that I can no longer be Father Giovanni because you can't be Father Giovanni when you're a woman. So I had to definitely step down from being that. I felt like in that process, I lost the respect of a lot of my own kids and the kids temporarily because people were confused. People didn't understand why I was going through this. But what they didn't understand is that it's not something new. I have been going through this my whole entire life. And so, but it was new to them. And people didn't understand that. A lot of people that are not, were not my kids, but were my babies because they were other young youth that respect me and looked up to me didn't understand it. And what happened was is that for a moment I felt like I became kind of like a laughing stock. Like people didn't take me seriously. People were disrespectful to me online. People were dismissive of me. People were happy that I was falling off. People were not in my face but online. That was what the information I was getting back. And I had to deal with that. And even though I didn't like it, I understood it. And the thing about it was is that at the point, I was at one of my lowest points because, you know, I wasn't going to school anymore. You know, I left school because of my drug addiction and because I didn't feel like I was where I wanted to be in my transition. So, you know, I decided to, within that period, I decided to get off drugs so I could pour into my transition because I was like, okay, you're doing this, you're not gonna stop, and you wanna be the best that you can be. So I got clean. I had some legal problems that I had got handled. And today I've been clean and sober for over 2 years. I don't do any drugs, I don't drink. And I just live a different life now. And I felt like my transition's going wonderfully. I have a legal name change. I work a full-time job. I don't escort anymore. I don't sell drugs anymore. And it was the best decision I've ever made for myself. And I've never looked better. So, you know, it was a thing. Now, the thing about it, back to now, would I ever go back and maybe want to revisit opening a house or restarting a house, Giovanna? I think that what was needed to be done was done as far as the House of Giovanna is concerned. So what I do want to give back to the community, and I am giving back, and I have some things that are going to be coming up, some huge things that are coming up. I want to help other gay youth, trans youth, with the projects I have going forward. I don't want to talk too much about it because it's on the table, but I do want to, it looks like it's going to be going down. Because I feel like I have a lot to offer the community, I have a lot of experience, and I have a lot of genuine care, concern, and love for this community because I've seen where it's come from, I see where it's at, and it's really at a place where so much positivity can happen, you know, because there's so many people here now. There's so many people here from other places that are new to Albany, there's so many beautiful trans women of color here, there's so many beautiful gay men and gay women that I'm seeing that are in our community that have talents and have professional positions in life that would really, they could pour back into the community to help. I want to help people to be able to enrich our community, to put it on a plateau, to maybe, you know, help. There's a huge epidemic going on right now with the crystal meth that a lot of kids are getting involved with that didn't know that was going to hit them as hard as it did, that have lost a lot. I've seen a lot of lives lost due to that, and so I would love to be able to help. I've been able to stay clean for this long. I would love to be able to help people to get their lives together if they really want to overcome their addiction, and help people to find out who the best perversion of themselves are.
Well, just like in 9/11, it brings, for me anyway, it brought about a heightened sense of my own personal safety. And so for karaoke nights on Friday nights, I was watching people as they came in. What were they carrying on their backs? Certainly 9/11, I was like, who's coming in? See, I think that it has certainly affected how I view myself in spaces. And, you know, I've always been cautious about guarding my back and looking for the exits and those kinds of things. So that's not new for me. But certainly, you know, just not feeling safe for sure. I think that's kind of past its point. I think I'm starting to feel safe again. But I do remember when that happened, and I thought, you know, first off, those poor people and all those families and just that whole community, you know, that did happen here.
I think it really affected me in the fact that it was the safe place for us to go, that we didn't have to worry about what's happening in the outside. Because, you know, you falsely believe that when you're with everybody that you're with, you're safe. You know, and that's, you know. But before that, I would joke that I used to sit in the window of Waterworks and call it the drive-by shooting window. Because I said, someday, jokingly, I would say in like early 2000, someday somebody's going to just shoot one of us, you know, homosexuals sitting here. And I used to joke about it, and when that happened, I was like, man, I didn't realize it could truly happen. And I just, and not to this day, if I'm at Rocks and someone comes in and they just walk back and forth, I'm not a violent person. I am not going to sit there and let someone attack me. I'm going to go after them. I've got my fist ready, and I'm just not the type that's gonna let you do something. And then if they got a gun, what am I gonna do? But I am not just gonna sit there and let somebody, you know. If six people attack me, I'm taking at least three of them out. Because I don't fight fair. I will kick, I will scratch, I will bite, and I'll spit, and where I spit, no grass grows ever, let me tell you.
And then, later that year, November 25th, I want to say it was November 25th of 2016, though it wasn't an LGBTQ instance, it did happen at Rocks again, where there was a shooting and a young man unfortunately was killed. And then I think a few people were injured, and some of our community who did work at Rocks at the time were actually in there. After we just went through Pulse, now you're going through it again. What was that feeling again like for you?
I wasn't there that night, but I know a couple of the bartenders were there, and they were so afraid because, you know, the first thing you think of, oh my God, another Pulse. You know, and they were probably thinking like somebody's in here to kill us. And it had to be the most frightening moment of their life. It had to be.
I wasn't there either. It was on Thanksgiving Eve.
Yeah.
And I didn't go out that night, but I did get a lot of calls the next morning because, you know, my family was concerned, my friends were concerned that I was there. And I'm like, no, I wasn't there, thank goodness. But
everybody assumed it was just another hate crime or perpetrated towards the gay, you know, the gay GLBT.
And that wasn't the case, thank goodness.
Yeah.
And then, of course, on T-Door of last year, no, not last, not 2023, 2022, Club Q in Colorado.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And then even before that, we get to, you know, in COVID, where gay bars were being attacked, you know, just from people, whatever, they're burning down flags and whatnot. But when you're looking at this uptick in violence towards the LGBTQ community, you know, how does that, you know, what does that do to a person? How does that make you feel?
Well, I think initially you're scared, you know, but you can't live your life in fear. You have to be prepared to, for something to happen, even if it may not. But I do. I squarely blame one person for this unleash of all this hate in the world. I truly only blame one person, and that's our former president.
Yeah, I think it starts at stages. I think it starts as fear, and then it's like anger. I get so angry sometimes I cry. And when I cry, I laugh. But it's just, why does anybody hurt anybody? I don't get it.
I know.
I don't get it. I just, when I was just, I would, I should have done it last night. I watched the January 6th documentary. And people that were talking there were just so hateful. And they were calling them patriots. It's like, how can you call someone who's beating a policeman with the spear a patriot? I just don't get it.
That's I hate that word. I just can't stand it because they use it in that way.
Yeah.
They use it in a way that, it's so senseless.
I hate that word.
I just hate patriot. I can't stand it. I love to be patriotic. That's the difference. But a patriot is...
I don't even watch a football team go to the Patriots anymore.
So what the hell happened to the Pride Center 2017? So I'm going to start this by saying it's really hard to run a nonprofit on small budgets and with a small staff. People are overtaxed and overworked. It is really, really difficult. I think around 2015 is when the executive director, Curran Street, left. Took a job somewhere else, like moved across the country type of deal, and they needed to put a new executive director into place. And there were a couple of candidates. I, myself, another white transmasculine person, and then two cisgender women of color were part of the staff interview team, in addition to like the board interview team for these organizations, or for these candidates. And to be frank, there was a candidate that we thought was wholly unqualified to be the executive director for the Pride Center. Could not answer our questions about how to support trans people, about how to support queer communities of color. And it was really unfortunate because there were other skills that person brought. Ultimately, a different person was hired, but we told the board, this is not the right candidate for us. So they hired somebody else. And then that person was the executive director for a bit. And in December 2016, I received a call from the board telling me that they had fired the current executive director and that a new one would be starting in 2 weeks. And that James Schultes and I, as the other directors, were gonna kind of run things in the meantime to the best of our ability with the board support. They told us who was being put in place. I expressed significant concern. And I think at that moment, I knew that my time at the Pride Center was gonna end soon. It didn't feel right anymore. I knew that we were putting somebody into place whose values I could not align with. And so there were some difficulties at the beginning of 2017. James Schultes left about a month before me. I left after that. And to be honest, it was also a good time for me to leave the nonprofit in order to start my own business. People started calling to have trainings from me,
not from the Pride Center. And I knew that that was my sign. So I, as ethically as possible, told the Pride Center that I was gonna be leaving and, like, you know, here's how I believe we should carry out the rest of the contracts. I'm not taking any clients with me. Doing that above board was really important to me. We agreed on it, the executive director and I, like, we had a good plan, and I bring this up because I went back and looked at board meeting minutes that happened that month, like 6 months afterwards, and learned that the board had been told that I had done that unethically, that I had stolen clients, I had poached. When in reality we agreed on a plan that I presented. So there's a lot of hurt there. During those first few months of 2017, there were a number of mistakes that were made. And mistakes happen. We're all human. We're all gonna mess up at some point. But the mistakes kept happening in a way that was really clear that we had never had with our the last two executive directors that I was there for. And it showed me that, like, the call that me and those three other staff had made a year or so prior in saying this person's not right for the job, and then they get hired later, it showed me that we were right. Our trans staff did not feel like they had support, and we were really struggling. After I left, I watched the trans women, trans feminine staff there really struggle to feel like people had their back. The inciting incident that folks recall is that the executive director posted an article on the Pride Center's Facebook. Right, and organizations kind of frequently do this. We boost other messages, other signals, other news articles, things like that. But this one was essentially about whether trans women get to be in women's spaces, I believe. And it was kind of posted with this question of, like, what do you think? Which is not really the kind of open door that we want on social media. And it just started a firestorm. It was one of the first times that I learned that when an organization or an entity makes a post about something that might be considered controversial, we have to keep really careful eye on the comments or disable the comments if we're kind of posting something that's like a public statement of ours. There was really harmful things put in there. Our trans, at this point I had left, I was trying to support the trans women staff the best I could from afar, like after having left my own job. And the community was split, you could say. There was a lot of folks who pointed out that posting this article is not okay. Folks, really getting behind the trans women on staff and trans women in general. And there were people who chimed in who supported the executive director, but I think even went beyond that, right? The executive director didn't post it with any ill intent. I think posted it just not thinking it through. But it brought in this whole slew of people in other locations that were already doing a lot of, like, anti-trans women work and organizing and messaging and books and things like that. And so it attracted all of this attention. And I think that incident, that moment, is when the local trans community lost what trust it had rebuilt with the Pride Center in the years before that. I think having James and I at the Pride Center and a few other staff, right, before us and during us, we had rebuilt trust with a lot of trans communities, not everyone, but that trust was lost in the spring of 2017.
When it comes to loss of community members, child, it's been a lot. And you know, it's been crazy. From Dean Kimbrough, who somebody I knew. I remember Dean back from In Our Own Voice back in the day.
It was so amazing. She was always happy. She cared about others, loved helping people, especially her mother. She loved going to school. She finished Hudson Valley, got her associate there, and then went on to SUNY Albany and got her bachelor's degree in science. 3.0 average. After she graduated, she was waiting for her degree to come in the mail. She was planning on going to physician assistant school for 2 years. She was going to take care of her cousin, Isaiah Johnson, who's bedbound now. He had MS, so she was like, Mommy, this will help me, you know, with some of the stuff I might be learning at physician assistant school. She had to decide on which one she was going to. She had like Atlanta, California, Miami, and I was trying to get her to stay and go to Albany. Oh, and Maryland. My cousin in Maryland, Lamisha Cancer, Williams, wanted her to come there, and she said she would go with her. So she was looking forward to the summer and then heading off to school.
I was very close friends with Kayla Stanley. I had been up to their home. My family's been up to their home several times. So that's a subject that's really, really close to home for me.
Jason's passing was a really sacred journey. It started about a year before that he asked me if I would help his dream come true of bringing his poetry into the world. He wanted to write a book of poetry, and he had been writing poems for a few years at that point with themes of what it means to be a black man, a gay black man, living with HIV, his feelings around social justice and the changes that we need locally, nationally, around the world. His poems were brilliant, and they would just come to him, and he would just put them into his iPhone. And so he asked me if I would just help review and edit and go over. And at that time, he was sick at that time. So we started meeting every Saturday, and we thought that he had recovered from his cancer, and so he was in remission, and we just thought we would be full steam ahead and excited about this book and finishing up our reviewing. But the cancer came back with a vengeance, and ultimately we knew that it was just a matter of time. So Jason welcomed 5 of his family members who all have special gifts around publishing and writing and all these things. We came together, we were his dream team. And so we would meet every Sunday at that point on Zoom to make his book a reality. And the day before he passed, we actually finished and we got a physical copy of Words in Bloom, that's his book, into his hands. And he passed away peacefully the next day.
Dominique had a heart of gold. She absolutely loved people. She always wanted to be the savior of people, and she had a high energy spirit, and so she was very well liked because of that. She was very easy to make friends, and she basically said what she meant and meant what she said, so that was a good character of hers. But the most remembrance of Dominique was that she was very friendly and very loved because of that character of just meeting people where they're at and not being judgmental and being loving and caring. So Dominique started out, you know, similar to most young people these days, wanting to be a rapper, a singer, and she grinded at that. The first time I heard it, I was like, girl, go sit down, right? And I watched her grow to when I first seen her, one of her first shows at 106.7 Park, which is a big radio station in New York, was one of her big performances. She blew me out. I could not believe that she went from what I seen her 3-4 years to that. So I definitely seen the entertainer in front of me. So she was an entertainer. She also decided that she was trying to fund herself. So it was never about working, it was about having her own business. So she was a black entrepreneur at this natural right. She knew early that she did not want to work for anybody. So she started selling clothes. She started selling CDs. She started making videos. And that she was able to take care of her business. She became a minority woman contractor very early in age. I mean, always seeking out how can she legitify her business and legitify herself being a black entrepreneur. So that was really huge for Dominique. Some of her milestones were, so she won the Young Entrepreneurship Entertainment Award for 106 Point Park. She also won the most inspiring clothing line out of Miami, Florida for black entrepreneurs. She also got picked up by the show called The Shy. A lot of people don't, so you know The Shy. So she got picked up for The Shy, and that was the year of her death. So people was noticing her clothing line, and that was huge. She received a contract for one of the biggest clothing lines out of Florida, who was trying to get her to move down there because they got tired of the back and forth thing with her. So she was really on her way moving down to Florida to host this big clothing line of YRR. And that was her signature. When she first came up with that signature, she had to be around 18, 19 years old. And I did not like it. I was like, YRR, what does that mean, right? As an older mom. But I will tell you that that is her legacy. And YRR is huge in this community and to the people who loved her. And so her clothing line legacy is right now trying to be picked up by programs that want to highlight black entrepreneurs and showcases. We actually, after Dominique's death, we've actually pursued her contracts, and we're in the middle of trying to be picked up by one of 50 Cent's lines, who wants to use YRR as one of the themes of young black LGBT women. And so that was her legacy. Her LGBT road came in college. So I remember her trying to tell me before college that she was a lesbian. And I was like, girl, go sit down with this stuff. How do you change on me, right? But we all know that coming out can be really, really difficult. And so when she got to college, I guess she explored that a lot more and found her voice. And when she came back at 18 and a half, 19 years old, she was firm that's what she was going to be. And like it or not, right? And so she moved into those areas, and I was very proud of her in those areas. So that is her last couple years before she died.
John, who, you know, was the partner of Joey Matos, him, you know, unfortunately passing away.
Ken Scratton was an incredibly sensitive soul for all of his outspokenness and his incredible, standing up for all. He was very sensitive, and he deeply, deeply appreciated every act of kindness, every kind word. Whenever we were together, there's generations of families who grew up knowing him or experiencing him, and he was always getting accolades. Every single one meant so much to him sincerely. He truly, truly loved people, and Ken was an incredible pioneer. You know, he was the first black journalist in all of upstate New York. Like, he totally, like, made history in that sense. He was openly gay as well. He never hid that or anything. And when he retired from being on the air on television, he took his advocacy to social media, and he just went all out. And he was adamant about it, and And I just think about his huge laugh, and I think about his presence, I think about his hugs, and we had the deepest of conversations where he would just share his soul with me and likewise with mine.
We lost a lesbian couple in Lansingburg and their two children. They were so young and they were murdered. I want to say their name was, I don't want to butcher her name, it was Shanta and her partner. But that was heartbreaking. That was like the first time I had seen up here actually about, you know, LGBT people being killed.
It'd be family friends killing another family friend, if not a cousin of a cousin, because most people here in Albany intertwine with other families. Like my family intertwined with like the cancers. Just a lot of people here, you know, and the person that killed Sid, me and his uncle been childhood friends since like fourth, fifth grade. Yeah, so it was hard. You know, the aunt, the guy aunt Sid used to model for, you know. What I hate about it is a lot of people don't speak up, you know. They go to Facebook, whatever, say little comments. Don't condone that. Let people know, no, we're not going for that. No, that's not right. And again, like I said, funeral, I told people, if you know something, say something. That's the only way we're gonna get them to stop, to let them know that we're not having it. We're not having it. This is our hometown. And either we're gonna leave or we gotta step up and let people know. I mean, we gotta start having a relationship with the police officer. No more of that snitches get stitches. They depreciate in the value of our homes and stuff. I'm a taxpayer, and I know a lot of other people is taxpayer. Talk to your kids. You see them doing wrong, excuse me, if you see them doing wrong, let them know that's wrong and I'm not tolerating that. Because my kids know I wasn't tolerating that. You're not coming in my house talking about, mommy, I'm about to make this money, you know, this whole, no, I'm not doing that, no. It's a wrap, no, you can move out. You can move out, but I've never really had that problem.
You know, before it impacts the community, it impacts the individual families. And so one of my stances on that is that, you know, we gotta stay, you know, connected to our kids and hear the plights that they're having in their life, you know, whatever that may be. And that is some of my regrets. You know, when I didn't follow the communication line, when I heard a beef was going on, you know what I mean? The other thing is, you know, if you have a child and they are having problems with other people in this community, you know, we just can't just walk away and say, you figure it out. You know, you figure it out. Because you're over 18 or over 21. And I think as a parent, that as the kids get a little older, we still need to take time to feed into them. So that's one of my pet peeves. But one of the things I talked about that year, which is still on the table, is that it is ludicrous how easy it is to buy a gun. That is an issue. That is a real issue. And I don't really have an answer to that, besides for, you know, when the police hear about, you know, places and things and people, they need to step it up. When people are selling guns and they're being known for that, I say you follow that trail, right? It's the same thing they do with drugs. You know what I mean? They find someone who's selling drugs, they follow that trail, they shut the, they need to do that same thing with guns. But the other thing is not to get too political with it. You know, the biggest fight is, you know, who's bringing all these guns here? It ain't the poor black boy, you know, so I, you know, I go back and forth with that, you know, so people are bringing guns in this town, and instead of having the beef die its natural death, or you duke it out, or whatever, now they are picking up guns, and it is a horrible thing. So we need tougher gun laws, we need tougher task force. I think a lot of deaths could be, you know, not have happened if those things would have happened. You know, the other thing is the random deaths. Like, we got Destiny Green, you know, who died. You know, like, come on now. You know, about the young, the 11-year-old that died over there on First Street from a stray bullet. That's horrific. You know, what do we do with that? And, you know, we're still looking at the system. The system is still is failing the poor and the minority. And so you get more time for drugs than you do for murder and attempted murder. They are giving drug dealers 10 to 15 years, and they're giving attempted murder 10 to 15 years. How does that add up? Like, that doesn't add up to me, you know? And not so much for Dominique's death, because I will tell you, today is the first day of Dominique's trial of the person who murdered her. It's today. Yeah, I did not go to that because I know today is just the formalities of it, but the trial of Dominique's murder has started today. And one of the things that I know, looking at the past of everybody else, their trial for murder, they don't treat it as important as it is drugs. So taking somebody's life is important, you know, regardless of the scenario. If you take someone's life, that should be taken seriously, more seriously. And it shouldn't make a difference whether you're black or poor, right? Or, you know, what the circumstances are. If you purposely went out to take somebody's life, I think that our laws need to be upped in that area.
I like to, sometimes I end calls by being good to yourself. But the most inspiring thing I think I would like to say is, always be at a place where you are truly humbled, and that you call people in versus calling people out, and look for that 2% in someone that you have in common. There's a bunch of people that I would say I have a lot of 2% in, but they're also, over the time, that 2% also shifts, and that's that commonality. But I think the biggest thing is knowing your history and doing your homework like you're doing right now. You said it's not just good enough to have these narratives out here. Let me dig a little deeper and let me do my homework.
Stand up, pull up, put up, grow. Don't forget the press cause if I say so. Say stand up, pull up, put up, grow. Don't forget your press cause if I say so.
I don't give a minute getting slaughtered for mothers like mine at this time.
With all of my might, I'ma fight, and I don't got to be polite. No toxic lover, you ain't got the right. This is for my God's order. On a mind, there's a slow slaughter. Fuck your gaslight when the last time you fought for her. Make your tongue sound divine when you call for her. Say her name in your rhymes when the cops call her. Know that she was on the grind for the cops caught her.